सर।
Okay, very good, very good. So, with the permission of the chair, Professor Rajbir Sharma, and the speaker, Subhan, we'll just start this off today. In fact, we've had to twice postpone this very, very important presentation. So I'm happy that we're finally able to get it off the ground. I just wanted to say one or two things to begin with and then hand it over to Professor Sharma. The first thing is that the work that Professor Khan is doing is of added importance, given that the government has just set up a committee to understand the culture of India going back to about 12,000 years. And I'm very happy to say, at least from the reports in the press, that one of our fellows is on that committee. So we are very, very proud of him, Dr. Balram Shukla. He has been put on the committee by the Ministry of Culture. If he's here, then
धन्यवाद सर। नमस्कार।
हाँ जी, बहुत 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 बधाई हो। आप भी कुछ कहिएगा, कमेटी का क्या दायरा है और आपका उसमें क्या, आपकी क्या भूमिका रहेगी, हम सब सुनना चाहेंगे। और एक दूसरी चीज जो इस प्रेजेंटेशन में आ रही है बाहर, वो ये कि जो हमने राखी गढ़ी की बात सुनी थी प्रेस में, you know, the whole Aryan invasion theory is now completely in tatters, it would seem, and yet there are some issues, especially about language, you know, because the linguistic and philological component of that whole interaction has not been fully sorted out. And of course Balramji is a linguist as well. Now the important thing though is that the counter argument is that 12,000 years is a long time back, and the Harappan culture that even today we are going to talk about is going to be something like 2600, going back to 2600 before the current era, not to 12,000 or 10,000 before the current era. I think Professor Bhan will say something about that, I hope. And then the argument is that by the time we come to about 1500, 2000, before the current era, then we have to look at another set of evidence, because the genetic evidence 12,000 years ago shows very little admixture of the so-called South Asian people with European people or Central Asian people. That is the new DNA tracking report that has come out in some journals. So that was one point that I wanted to raise. The second point, which I think is very crucial, is that Professor Bhan's work deals with crafts, material culture, not with language and other things. But he has in his abstract talked about technology and the production methodology of these crafts, and their spread and dissemination, the techniques, the materials, and then the provenance of these crafts. I think this gives us, through these objects, I think the objects tell their own stories. This is what I was trying to say. So texts tell a story. Like if you look at a text, or if you look at, you know, trying to decipher an ancient script, the Harappan script, again, we don't know whether it's fully deciphered or not. There's a lot of debate on that. I won't go into it. But all I'm trying to say is that texts tell one story, but objects tell another story. Objects are also very eloquent, you know, in their testimony of history, prehistory, and of course, in this case, archaeology. So I'm going to invite Professor Bhan to speak. But before that, I must say, friends, that once again, you know, I don't want to be the bearer or of bad tidings, but I already mentioned to you, Professor Hitendra Patel's father, I think, passed away a little while ago. Many of us have sent our condolences to him already. We should be hearing from him. I hope everybody's fine in his home. And just the other day, we also got the news that one of our former members of our society of IIS, who was also very influential because she was Secretary, Ministry of Culture, and held many other very high-ranking positions in the government, was herself a very, very gifted artiste. She was a trained dancer in many, many of our classical dance forms. But she was also a great scholar and a cultural administrator. Some would have called her a Tsarina of Indian culture. I'm, of course, referring to Dr. Kapila Vatsyayan, who passed away. And some of you may have remembered how she came to our Tagore Memorial Lecture 2 years ago when Dr. Ramesh Chandra Shah was the speaker. And she came to our RK, Radhakrishnan Memorial Lecture, which the Dalai Lama gave last year. So 2 years ago, she was with us. And again, last year, she was with us. So with these few words, I would invite all of us to have a moment's silence, please. And when we come out of that, then I will hand over the entire proceedings to our chair, Professor Rajveer Sharma. So let's have a moment of silence, please. Thank you. Request Professor Rajveer Sharma kindly take over, and we look forward to hearing Professor Bhan. I may have to leave now, but I'll see if I can join in a little later. Thank you. Thank you all.
Thank you. Thank you, sir, for a very, very kind of introduction. In fact, you have made my task very simple. But at the same time, we welcome Professor Bhan, who has taken a very important study from the viewpoint of the cultural evolution as well as the evolution of the society as well as the polity in India since ancient times. We all know that the Harappan civilization was found in the 1920s and thereafter. The continuous excavations are going on in different parts of the country. And I therefore, first of all, welcome you all and welcome Professor Bhan. Before I request Professor Bhan to present his research, I would like to introduce, though he doesn't need much of introduction, he is an established archaeologist. Professor Kuldeep Kumar Bhan was formerly the chairman of the Department of Archaeology and Ancient History, MS University of Baroda, Gujarat. He was also the director and the curator of the Archaeological Museum of the MS University of Baroda. Dr. Bhan was born in and raised in Srinagar. He completed his early schooling in bachelor's education from University of Kashmir, and thereafter he shifted to MS University of Baroda, from where he did his master's, MPhil, as well as PhD. Now, over the past almost 25 years, Dr. Bhan has collaborated in major excavation at several important settlements of the Indus civilization in Gujarat. Though these settlements are small, but they were flourishing trade and craft production centers of Indus civilization. He has also excavated numerous other settlements that belong to periods both preceding and following the Harappan cities. He co-directed the bead project with Professor J.M. Kenner and Professor Massimo Vedel. Dr. Bhan's social expertise lies in ancient technologies and crafts, which has led him to study a broad range of cultural periods, to which I think आपका सप्तांश पे हिंटेड एट ई आर टॉट साउथ एशियन आर्कियोलॉजी एंड एंशियंट टेक्नोलॉजी इन द डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ आर्कियोलॉजी एंड एंशियंट हिस्ट्री एट MS यूनिवर्सिटी बड़ौदा एज डायरेक्टर एंड क्यूरेटर ऑफ द आर्कियोलॉजिकल म्यूजियम ऑफ द महाराजा शिवाजीराव यूनिवर्सिटी ऑफ बड़ौदा ही हैज प्लान मेनी एग्जीबिशंस that are toured various places in India and abroad. Dr. Bhan has successfully collaborated with many Indian and foreign research projects. With these words, I must also add that not only his academic background, but the present research pursuits reflect that he is a very high quality researcher and shows high scientific scholarship of Professor Bhan. In fact, Professor Bhan is a man of field, and therefore his research is in that sense very, very original. And I think it would not be wrong to say that the Indus Valley civilization, which in fact has been progressing and may have a very deep bearing on finding out the cultural evolution of our country, would go a long way in that direction. Let me also add here that I hope that Professor Bhan would tell us about as to how the craft of those times and how the craftsmanship really impacted the social organizations of our country. Whether in those times the Indian society was a stratified society or was it an egalitarian one, some views we may hear from Professor Bhan today. In fact, many people say that the Varna system, which we find later in various ancient history books, particularly in the Vedic and the post-Vedic period, including Kautilya's Arthashastra, that there was some kind of a varna system existing. And some people say that even during the Harappan civilization, the Indian society was characterized by a varna system, and that it was a stratified society rather than some kind of egalitarian ones. There was, for example, a reference for three kind of varnas. There were priests, there were rulers, and the producers. So I am not an expert on the Harappan civilization. I would request Professor Bhan to kindly make his presentation. Professor Bhan.
I think Professor Paranjpe has already left. I'm thankful to him for his very kind words. Can you hear me, please?
Sir, how is that?
There is an echo. I think Professor Rajveer Sharma is twice connected, so the echo is creating a problem.
In fact, there anybody is a problem when my connection and Professor Bhan's connection have unfortunately been connected together.
So there's some problem there. That's what I thought.
I would like to thank Professor Rajveer Sharma for agreeing to preside over my lecture and for his kind words. I share a room, I study with him, and I have been association with him since 7-8 months also. So I'm thankful for his company. I would like to thank also the anonymous evaluator of my proposal, who cut short my 6 months from Shimla. I'm really thankful to him for it, because of the COVID-19, I feel fatigued. Neither my wife can come, neither I can go. So it's a good blessing from him to me. Now, coming back to my lecture, The monograph I was planning to write has 6 chapters. Chapter 1 is the archaeological approaches to technology and some problems in archaeology of Harappan crafts. This chapter has been, the first draft is ready, and maybe within 1 or 2 days it will be ready with me. The second chapter, which basically summarizes the Harappan studies in Gujarat with a special emphasis on the sites that are closely related to various crafts, manufacturing areas, and are close to resource areas. This chapter will highlight the dependence of major urban centers on the smaller settlements situated near outlying resource areas for the supply of raw material as well as for the unfinished and finished goods. This chapter I still have to start because I was thinking I will write it in December when I'm back in Baroda, because most of the references are there in Baroda. The chapter third, this chapter has been completed. It is the organization of Harappan crafts, craft production of different crafts, levels of state control and political complexity. Some of the important themes that would be discussed in this chapter are the segregation and control of production, the organization of craft, production and political control, and the question of part-time specialists. So I have completed, as I told you, that I already completed this chapter. The chapter fourth, I have rough draft is with me, but I need to work on it once I'm back in Baroda, because most of the reference verses, sorry, not this chapter, chapter four is basically a key chapter. This is what I was working for the last year for only on this chapter. This reviews the record of Harappan craft productions from two complementary point of view. Technology as reflected in the series of manufacturing cycles. I have given the two lectures already on it, describing the formation process of artifacts, how the artifacts are produced. Secondly, activity areas where in a Harappan archaeological site where such activities were carried out, mainly in terms of formation, processes of archaeological context, and sediments. Because this is very important. If you excavate a site and you happen to be excavating a municipality dump and there is a lot of manufacturing waste coming from those that hasn't been dumped, you have to be able to differentiate between a workshop and a municipality dump. So it was from that point of view, the how positively these things have been identified, and how the workshops, craft quarters, dumping areas have so far been published, and which are sure that they are not dumps only. So that chapter took me. That chapter was the main key. That is the key to the whole book. The chapter five summarizes the internal long distance trade networks. The networks, both internal and long distance, because as you know, the Harappan had their trade relation with up to Mesopotamia, Oman, which I will show you some of the slides at the end of my lecture. And also, they also have the internal trade networks. A lot of shell going from Gujarat to main Harappan sites in Sindh, because shell is not, Arabian Sea is not there, the Gulf is not there, the Gulf of Kutch is not there, where the shell is found. So this chapter would be basically on the trade networks. I have completed my last chapter, that is discussion and conclusion. And as the scholars continue to reveal the complex features of Harappan technology, we are able to define the role of these crafts in the maintenance of urban centers and compare these patterns with those of Western Asia. While in the past, the Harappan civilization was thought to have been at receiving end of technological diffusion from the West, it is becoming more and more apparent that these are inadequate models. Current investigation of information exchange and control of knowledge are gradually breaking away from the bonds of directionality that dominate the diffusion models. Further, the comparison of production techniques and the use of finished objects within the Harappan tradition itself will be extremely important. Though such approaches will begin a more meaningful discussion of independent invention, shared and restricted knowledge. This chapter I completed. That means out of 6 chapters, I have completed the 4 chapters, 2 chapters I need to work on more on it. Now coming back to my today's lecture, In my earlier two presentation, I presented the operational skills of manufacturing of various herpan crafts, and that formed the basis of the more important and key chapter 4 of the present. Here I am giving you two examples which I already have talked in my second lecture. This is the operational sequence of bangle manufacture, that is how the bangles were made out of the shell. The more stages indicating the complex technology. If there are only two stages of manufacture, then there is not, we consider it's not a complex technology. If it goes through number of stages of manufacture, which I will perhaps talk when I'll be talking, talking further. So if there are various stages, you can also know the labor. How many laborers would have been employed in to produce a bead? But then for that, you have to have an understanding. Then how bead is made? Not archaeologists know when they go for excavations, they really don't know how many stages of bead goes through. So a lot of confusion when they come to the conclusions, these conclusions are not based on sound background. Immediately, a question must have come to my mind, why should study herpan crafts people? Why we got interested in? The answer to this is, the answer is very simple. First, their products are extremely appealing. I got attracted to them. They are generally small, but often elegant, colorful, and aesthetically pleasing. Now, if you look at this, I'm showing this with my cursor. These beads are not more than a millimeter long. They are made of statite. If the Mesopotamians and Egyptians took pride in producing the monumental things, Indian always took the pride in producing a very small objects. The smaller it is, the more beautiful it was. Perhaps that is the Indian aesthetics, which still continues when we talk of miniatures, when we look at our sculptures. So the monumentality is not appreciated. Beautiful beads. And if you look at this necklace, if I calculate, it would have taken 7 years of five or seven workmen working on it to produce such necklace. I'll be talking to you how. So they are beautiful, they are aesthetically pleasing, they are colorful, they are small. And another important thing is that sometimes you also feel that Harappans had achieved a kind of perfection. In many instances, it is evident that the Harappan craftspeople did their best to hide any possible evidences of techniques they used to apply, and often they have been successful. So usually, when you look at a finished bead, you hardly know how it could have been made. If you look at this bead, you hardly can make out how. So the efforts of reconstruction of such techniques is a prolonged, beautiful game of chess, where the researchers is constantly be checked by the skill of the Harappan people in hiding their manufacturing techniques. Secondly, one of the important approaches to understand socio-political structure of Harappan society is through the reconstruction of the operational sequences of various specialized crafts, which are thought to reflect occupational specialization, urban segregation, and stratification. So, not only these are important, they are beautiful, the understanding the technique is a challenge for a researcher, but they have also potential us to give a lot of information about the socio-political structure of the Harappan society. And my presentation would primarily focus on how these reconstructions, which I have already talked in my chapter 4, and I already given two talks on them. My presentation would primarily focus on these reconstruction of operational sequences of crafts would help us to better understand the Harappan society rather than trying to be hyper-nationalists or try to prove or disprove Aryan migration theory by Kasi armchair archaeologists. Now, here is a map. You can say the Indus, Mesopotamia, Egypt, China. These are the earliest civilizations in the world. And what we see here, Mesopotamia is supposed to be the where the beginning of the wheat growing started, the domestication of cattle and sheep and goats started. That is early food producing era. But when you look at the Indus, we also have sheep and goat as well as wheat cultivation from the beginning, or much earlier than the Harappans, but it is indigenous. It is previously it was thought it came from Mesopotamia to Indus, but now we have come to as understanding that French and American archaeologists have studied a site at Mehrgarh in Balochistan near Bolan Pass, where we have the indigenous development of cultivation as well as the domestication. After some time, around about 550 BC, we see that a lot of regional culture is developed, what we call regionalization era. Each Gujarat had its own function. Sindh had a different type of cultural development. But around about 2600 BC to 1900 BCE, these proto-urban communities of the Indus and surrounding region appear to have attained some sort of political unification, and now we observe the growth of first urban centers of the South Asia. Now you can see this is around 2600 BC. These photographs are from the Dholavira, a site in the Kutch. These large cities and towns, not only that large cities were developed, you can see the regimental, which Professor Singh would say, autocratic sort of a society, where you see that very regimental sites with huge walls, huge fortification walls or periphery walls were made around, huge tanks. Here, these are cut into the stone with the copper tools, which are very soft. And you have around about 18 water tanks, which are interconnected at Dholavira. Fantastic people, you know. And this was because there's no much of rains in the Kutch, just a desert area, so to store the water there. An important aspect of this process of integration was the invention of specific styles of material culture. You can see not only do we see the development of architecture, we see huge number of crafts developing along with this. Now, as I told you, if you look at the beads, you could hardly understand how these can be made. If you look at these bangles, you will hardly understand how they were made. If you look at the ladle or the spoon, you hardly know. This is a step. What is important for an archaeologist is the manufacturing waste that answers our questions, that how these things were made. Like this is the manufacturing waste from a shell, which is known as tribunal of Iram, and by making these bangles, this is the for making the spoons, this is the manufacturing waste, this is the finished product. Now the question is, in the earlier excavation, these manufacturing waste were not collected, not much attention was given to them, and then that is the reason we cannot study many of the sites, because the material has not been preserved, which could have been reanalyzed. The industrial debris left by the artisan is a reliable marker for one of the important social differentiations. If you go to the Near East archaeology, if you go to Mesopotamia, Egypt, in Near East archaeology, written records of transitions between the people and institutions, and secondly, the iconography helped to understand the growth of political complexity. First, in the Near East, we have the written records. They have transacted between the institutions as well as the craftspeople, so you know what type of political growth was going on there. But in India, we don't have the written records. We do have written records, but they have not been understood or they have not been deciphered yet. And also, we lack iconography. You can see here, this is from Egypt. Here is the person who is using a bow to drill something. So we know that in Egypt, what type of, how things could have been made. But in Harappan archaeology, we have to rely on less direct approaches. It has always been assumed that the people of Harappan culture were organized in a stratified society made of different classes. In absence of written records, these statements are made on the basis of the layout of the settlements, how the settlements were laid, the use of writing, which has not been deciphered, and very standardized weights. The weighing system was very standardized. If you find the weight in a Harappan site of Kutch and you compare it with the weight found from the Harappa, Sindh, or anywhere else, they exactly weigh the same. So indicating, and also various occupational specializations. We also see this is from an archaeological site from Gujarat, where we have a workshop of bangle making. This is a workshop of fence making. I'm not going to detail how fence is made. Perhaps I already talked about it. This is the bead making. So various types of occupations we see, and specialization. You and me cannot go and start making beads. It has to have a specialization. So we see various types of occupational specialization developing during this time. Using simple hierarchical models, some Harappan scholars have suggested that ritual and political elites were supported by agriculturalists, traders, and range of service communities and craft specialists. There were water sewage. One of the earliest sewages were in the Harappan societies. So there would have been people who will look after those, carpenters. There would have been the masons who produce such a beautiful, wonderful. So a lot of specializations. You and me, I cannot clean the sewage. You need a specialization for producing the crops. So however, such model does not take into account the complex social, political, and economic relationship that are necessary in vast urban states. Well, we see this development, this hierarchical model that ritual and political elites were supported by agriculturalists, traders, a range of service communities, and craft specialists. But they don't explain or take into account the complex social, political, economic relationship that these are necessary in a vast urban cities. Segregation of activity area and standardization of the finished object. The production was standardized. If there is a bead produced in the Sindh, similar type of beads were produced here. So there was a standardization of the final objects. And also segregation. In a city, the things people used to live, various craft people used to live in different areas. And this is, they say, because of segregation of activity area and standardization of finished objects, we have occupational specialization, that there were people who were specialized in their occupation. And when they say this, there was an occupational specialization, that indicates control of production, control on the distribution, and socioeconomic stratification. While this appears to be a straightforward model, but there is a theoretical jump. Assuming segregation of specialized crafts can be attributed to the centralized control and socioeconomic stratification. What they say, what has been assumed, that there, if there is a segregated areas and there, if there is a centralization area, that leads to the centralized control and social economic stratification. But then it's not true. I will go and explain it in my lecture. One approach to understand socio-political structure of society is through the study of specialized crafts, which are thought to reflect occupational specialization, urban segregation, and stratification. That means let's try what the model they have put forward, earlier scholars, let's try whether it stands. Ethno-archaeological studies of a specialized craft indicate that there is no simple and direct correlation between the standardization and segregation of activities and the centralized control of production. The ethno-archaeological studies, we have carried out ethno-archaeological studies on stone bead making as well as for the shell making, and we have found there is no simple correlation between the standardization and the segregation, the basic facts they had taken into consideration that would reflect the centralized control of production. And let's take an example of the modern craft industry that is highly stratified and rigidly controlled by dominant merchant families is the agate bead manufacturing in Khambhat. This is the map. This is the place, Khambhat. It's also known as Cambay in the British time, but the actual name is actually the name of the site area is known as Khambhat. So we use the Khambhat. In this industry, groups have a close kin relationship or alliance with politically powerful individuals or organizations. Through these connections, they are able to control the flow of raw material, the production processes, and the distribution of finished commodities. This is the workshop we studied. I'm talking of only workshop. There are various types of workshops there, but I'm talking about only one workshop. And this is the workshop, which is known as Kesari Singh's workshop. It is highly controlled. And this, what they do. Here you can see, this is from an archaeological site. This is a semi-precious material kept in the bins. And when we excavated this site area, we didn't find any manufacturing waste associated with these bins. So these bins appears to have been a merchant who was dealing with the raw material. And you can see how the bins were made, how he was controlling it. As well as this, you can see the strong control of, because these people who had a shell workshop in this area, they controlled it because they had a constant supply of raw material, which used to come from 200 to 300 kilometers away from the site. So a person who had that relationship with the people or the fishermen who were having this shell, could have a workshop, and he used to control it because his quarter was next to his living quarter. Quarter was next to the production area, so he could keep an eye that nobody is stealing him shell from there. The bead industry, many stages of production are undertaken in dispersed localities, but part-time craftsmen. In a very controlled workshop, these workshop people, these are carried out at different places by part-time. They are not completely there. They may be agriculturalists. They may be also doing some other job, and the various stages are carried out by those people. Say, for example, chipping. For chipping the stone for making the beads is carried out by in the morning they will go to the craftsman. He will give them nodules by weighing them. In the evening they have to return back all the nodules as well as the manufacturing waste to the person, so he knows nothing has gone in between, has been stolen. Now if you look at this, I will highlight a bit. There are various stages of production, starting from mine. And this is controlled by the Sindhi Muslims. And at this stage, a chip is taken out from the nodule in order to check the quality of the material. Then because of they have a relationship, they purchase in bulk and they have been supplying this raw material to this controlled workshop from ages, and they purchase they've spent a lot of money in purchasing the raw materials. The second stage, the nodule has to be dried. It reaches the workshop. It is dried. Once it is dried, it has to be heated. The nodules have been heated. So here is the matkas, small handis in which they are heated. The first stage of heating is not necessary to convert the color, because carnelian is, this is what I call carnelian. Carnelian is red, orange, transparent bead. And it is the color which is important. This nodule doesn't have a color. It is because of the heating color changes. Now the question is, at the first stage, it doesn't change the color immediately, but what happens that it becomes softer, or it becomes easy, because most of the moisture gets relieved from the stone. It's easier to flake it. So you see there are various stages of flaking, and again heating, then again this. So it goes through, then they are ground, they are perforated, they are polished, but then it heating goes on in between. If you have this bead from this stage, which has not turned red, it has no value. So the most important and final stages of productions are heating the agate for changing the color and polishing of the beads are carried out by full-time specialists under the close control of the merchant. So he keeps a watch, because now the possibilities of things getting stolen. So he keeps a deep watch on them. Now, how we can find out this type of archaeologically, how it can be represented archaeologically? This was a modern example, ethnographic example, which I was given. The presence of merchants can be defined by a range of variables, including stocks of raw material. They can afford to buy a lot of raw material, tools of manufacture, finished commodities, critical stages of production, that is heating and as polishing. Recycling of specific manufacturing waste, because most of the waste, because they have a best quality material, most of the waste goes to Agra, where they are used for inlaying on the marble. And absence of other manufacturing waste. The chipping waste would not be there around that, because that is done in the separate area. Now, this is very important. If you look at this man, they purchase these Kesari Singh's workshop, purchases material of truckloads of material. But to produce a very long bead, this is the from which he can, because all nodules are not large enough to be produced into long beads. So only they can produce, every year they produce 200 or 300 long beads, and they go to the Nagaland for selling. And there is his brother. Stop sharing here, Amber. Besides, further, a combined domestic cum industrial architecture associated with the final stages of manufacture provides an important indicator for direct control. So the kilns you see here in this, they are associated with their house itself, because as I told you, it is the color of the bead which is very important, and that stage he wants to control. Nothing can be stolen because they are not finished by then. The archaeology centralization and control could only be defined by careful reconstruction of entire manufacturing process. Unless you really understand what gets produced at what stage of manufacture, you will not be able to find archaeologically those stages. By determining the raw material and its source, so for an archaeologist, first he has to find where from the raw material has come, what is the source area for that are needed for the production, the relative amount of labor is very important in the organization. So as I told you, unless the archaeologist knows how many stages the bead goes through, he will not be able to at least relatively say how many laborers could have been employed in such manufacture involved, and the spatial distribution of various stages of manufacture. That the spatial distribution of various stages of, and then for that you need to identify the stage or the sequence of the manufacture that has to. That's why, as I was trying to tell you, that manufacturing waste is very important for an archaeologist, because that tells us what type of stage or what sort of production was going on, or what was the stage of that production. These crafts could have been controlled through various means, such as these Harappan crafts could have been controlled by various means, such as control of raw material. Unless you have a raw material, you can't produce anything. So you can control raw material, you control everything. Technological know-how, how things are produced. Like as I told you here, this person is Nathubai. He tends the kilns of, very important kilns of Kesari Singh's bead making workshop. He has been working since 70 years there when we went in early 80s there to study this craft. So there has to be relations. If he controls him, he doesn't allow him to go to any other workshop, because he knows how to heat these beads. because a slight overheating would break the bead. He's going to be a loss. And since he's a very experienced kill tender, so he controls him. He can give him anything, you know, he can give him rewards, he can marry his daughter to someone, give money at that time. This is how they control the labor. Technological know-how, how the beads turn red, he only knows. So he controls the, he controls one of the important stages of manufacture. Distribution of goods. As I told you, the KC workshop, they don't sell beads to anyone. One brother produces in Khambhat, another sells them. He has a shop in Nagaland where the beads are in great demand. So distribution of, and the taxes. I was talking to Professor Rugbir Singh that we have a concept that the Harappan had a fortification. Fortification gives a connotation, they are associated with the army, military. But if I say periphery wall, the whole concept changes. And the gates, four gates of to enter into the city, perhaps were meant to be collect taxes. When I go with those beads to sell somewhere else, so I have to pay tax to the government. Or I have to, it's not necessarily the tax that we understand how the taxes are paid. That could be bartering as well. It is important, therefore, to determine the role of specific craft on overall economy and social structure of Harappan cities. Jane Kinoyer presents a very useful classification of ancient craft professions in Harappan society based on two lines of inquiry, very important, local versus non-local availability of raw material. If the raw material is locally available, then it is not very expensive. If I have to bring it from 600 kilometers to my site to produce something, then it is very important raw material. One line of inquiry is that he find whether the material is local or Harappans has used non-local material. And second, and the line of inquiry is the simple or complex technology, characteristic of technology. If a production goes through number of stages of production, then it's we call it complex technology. If it goes through one or two stages of manufacture, then we call it as a simple technology. On basis of this model, Harappan crafts can be divided into four categories. If we take the Professor Kinoyer's this model, then we find there are four categories of Harappan material. Crafts involved in the processing of locally available raw material with relatively simple technologies. Those crafts which were available, produced out of the locally available raw material and with very simple technologies like woodworking, terracotta ceramic production. Here you can see the terracotta produced from the one of the sites of Harappan, Gujarat. House building. This is Dholavira. They have used the local raw material. This is stone raw material. The whole city is made of local raw material because there's a lot of stone in the Kutch. But in Sindh, the Mohenjo-daro, it is completely brick architecture. So brick is made from the local clay. So simple technology, brick making is not a very complex process. So simple technology and local material. So we see the second. Those involved in the processing of non-local materials, the material is not local using relatively simple technologies, but the production is done by very simple technologies. Like stoneworking, chipping stones, ground and packet stones. Now this is from Gujarat. This has come travel 500 kilometers from Sindh, from the Rohri Hills to Gujarat to produce this type of blades with simple technology. But there's also a lot of local raw material being used for producing these type of blades. And this technique of using the local raw material and producing with simple technologies, very useful tools, has started in Gujarat at least 11,000 years before present. And it continued up to early centuries of Christian era. Now, third category of this Harappan is that those involved in more complex productions, complex production processes using local raw material. Very complex, basically very complex production techniques, but very local raw material. Stoneware bangles, I think I talked about stoneware bangles. I wouldn't have time this time to talk about stoneware bangles. These are stoneware bangles. But they were produced in these containers and they were closed before they were heated. You can see the stamp, a Harappan stamp on the mouth of this jar, indicating once they were put in the heat, nobody could tamper with it. Nobody could take it out. Elaborate painted specialized ceramics, very complex process, but local clay. Same for stoneware bangles, local, but lot of technological and especially pyrotechnology, where heat is, we don't understand, it is not heat, but it is the control of the heat which is more important. So that controlled heating system. Those involved with more complex production using non-local materials, first, very complex technologies as well as not using the local raw material. Say for example, shell. Shell was going from Gujarat and the technique of manufacture is also very complex. Metal working, metal has to be extracted then brought to the site because they won't bring the ore to the site unless in small quantities, and then producing bangles, there's metal vessels, metal axes, very complex technology, and material come from a large distance. These carnelian beads, faience work, very complex technology, and also material come from a long distance. Seal production of the seals. So we have seen these four categories. First and two categories have regional variations, while three and four are more standardized. If you look at this now, in the first two categories, we see a lot of regional variation. There is a lot of regional variation between Gujarat, but the ones which have complex technologies and local or long distance material, they seem to be standardized. So it's not that everything is standardized in. So that's why when Lothal was excavated, he found a pottery which not found in the Sindh. So for in his first publication in 1965, Professor Rao did not report the black and red ware found from the site because he thought then it will not remain Harappan. But he doesn't know, this is because there's such variation would happen where the local raw material and simple technologies have been used. Now, if we elaborate Quinoir's model for some time more, and we'll see a very interesting phenomena. Difficulty of procurement of raw material is on the x-axis. With the x-axis, we have plotted where the very difficult, the material has come, is very difficult to procure raw material. On the y-axis, we have some technological elaboration, how much technologically they are complex. And the whole thing has been divided, both x-axis and y-axis have been divided into low, high, medium, low, high, medium. This is a graph. The upper part, upper left and lower right corner represents two important and opposing trends. On the top, we have state level political organization, and at the lower level, we have the chiefdom level political organization. Now, if we plot on the, now we know which are the complex technologies, where from the raw material has come. Now, if you look at the, if you plot various crafts in this graph, majority of them crowd upper left corner. The majority of upper left corner, and expectation for developed state level organization that gives us idea this was a state level organization. The stoneware, for example, represents a significant statutory attitude towards the production of personal ornaments. So if you look at the ornaments, this, if you look at the chiefdom, it's all black. So we see that this was definitely a more state, early state formation rather than chiefdom, because a lot of people say this was the chiefdom. Certain crafts were segregated for controlling the production of important status items. Other craftsmen have been segregated, have not been segregated. Say, for example, this, they are not segregated. Every household used to produce blades. But you see the very lot of segregation in this. You see sort of segregation where there was a control. The uniformity of standardization of stone items such as weights, they are standardized, the weight is perfect the same. Seals may be attributed to rigid control, the introduction or production of the seals, because these seals have been used to close the doors, so they will be mud and they will stamp it. They will be they will be put on the boxes, which perhaps had commodities. They will be sealed on the doors, so indicating that it had an administrative role. So that indicates the seals, weights and the writings tell us that there was a very rigid control as well. While other objects such as pottery ornaments may have been standardized through kin-related learning processes or spread of kin-related artisans to different settlements. Well, the pottery also, we have a lot of standardization. As I told you, the complex, there are those excellent vessels, painted vessels. They also have been standardized. But then there could have been another mechanism for such. Another, if you look at the inventories of Harappan objects, as we have seen, other include ornaments and other items of the same type, similar in shapes and function, but made of different materials of contrasting values. If you look at the inventories of these Harappan objects, you will find similar objects having same function, having same shape, but they have been made into different materials of contrasting values. These beads, these long carlinated beads, are very expensive, as I told you, because they could not produce a number of times. But also we have terracotta. Terracotta is a baked clay. There's a lot of similar bicone beads made in clay. You can see the handi here, which is made in clay. Then we have the handis made in similar shape, similar function, handis in metal. You have bangles in shell, you have bangles in or made of copper, you have these very expensive bangles of stoneware bangles. For example, terracotta bangles, faience bangles, metal bangles, terracotta versus cardinal bangles. So while outsider might have perceived a set of ornaments simply as Harappan, if somebody outsider would look at it, he will conceive them as a Harappan. In this stage, the aesthetic appeal and the relative value of similar ornaments might have been an important media of social information and social comparisons. Because definitely those who were making food in a metal vessel were richer than the person who was making this, the person who was wearing carnelian. So we see this type of information coming from that. So this is again telling us or giving an indication of that how the social stratification had are reflected in these crafts. Now, if you look at the Gujarat, a lot of raw material has gone from Gujarat. Mostly the carnelian for making beads, it has gone from here up to most of the Harappan sites, because the best type of carnelian comes from Gujarat. Shell, because it comes from the Gulf of Kutch. The raw material comes from Gulf of Kutch. So we have a factory site here, we have a factory site here where these objects were made. Finished objects, unfinished objects were sent to not only to the Sindh, these main Harappan areas, but also across the Arabian Sea. This one, an architectural fragment of a limestone. You can see this limestone, which is found a lot around these the Dholavira site. On the basis of archaeometric is a white coat sands. That means that the such studies are carried out in a very sophisticated labs using very sophisticated instruments in order to trace elements in order to prove. So such, on the basis of archimetry, such studies, it has been proved that a lot of this material has gone from Dholavira up to Harappa. It's around about 900,000 kilometers. And such huge, we have to also think of such huge columns were lifted from Dholavira, the type of transportation they had. Now, let's try to understand something starting from the beginning. There is a map, but just keep an eye on it. We have four, if you look at the excavation of a Mehrgarh, which is in Balochistan, and near Bolan Pass, where excellent work has been done, and that indicates from the very beginning, from 30,000 years till Harappan times or till today, we have a continuous development. There is no migration of Harappans, but there is migration of Aryans coming to India and getting mixed or no. Now, I'm trying to tell you, explain that this in this. Trend one represents the basic technological attitude of a stabilized village community to experiment and innovate their basic local resources. Before this, or along during this period, during Lower Paleolithic, Middle Paleolithic, Mesolithic, or Microlithic, whatever period you call them, the socio-political organization was of a band, a nomadic band, 100 people coming together, moving in from one place to another. During the roughly at the end of maybe Mesolithic period, from band, we see that there is a beginning of experimenting with the first getting stabilized. People started living in the village. They are not nomadic. They're moving from one place to another. There's a beginning of stabilizing the village community to experiment and innovate with their basic resources. A lot of experimentation takes place with the local raw materials to produce their tools, or also with the domesticated wild animals, wild materials. Now, in the second stage, or the second trend, what we see at the Mehrgarh would be distinguished by the procurement of exploitation of rare and very exotic material for the production of status symbols. That is the chiefdom. They are settled villages, but they also use not only local material, but there is a tendency to get the very exotic raw materials and use them as a symbol of status. But they make these objects from a very simple technologies. This is reflecting in the early Neolithic graves dated to 7,000 to 5,000 BCEA. They also made the ornaments of lapis lazuli. This is the lapis lazuli beads from the same site, which comes from the raw material comes from the North Afghanistan, from Oxus Valley, Oxus River, Amu Deva, Darya. It's such a long distance this material is brought during this time. And if you enter in the third trend, they use local materials. They also use complex technology materials like copper or bronze. The hiring of the carnelian beads, elaborate seashell. This is the regionalization era when, as I told you, everybody and every stages, all there were a lot of cultures developing in various regions that we call the regionalization era. This is the layer third. This is a slightly advanced than the chiefdom. And the fourth stage, final stage, same at the same Mehrgarh. Finally, effectively, the whole course of 3rd millennium BC. This was happening around about 3rd millennium BC. Extreme, and this was of a very extreme consequences in the Harappan phase. It is distinguished by high level of technical complex technology, in craft industry and cheap, relatively local raw material. And this finally becomes, this indicates the production of stoneware bangles. Stoneware bangles were never produced of the Harappan times. Now slightly, I'm going to into the trade because I was talking about trade networks. This is from India was, according to the Mesopotamian sources, Harappan people were known as Mehlo. That was the area was known Mehlo, and the Oman was known as Magan because they had the texts. Now this is from an ivory comb of Indian origin found from Magan, that is Oman. These are again some of the beads, long carnelian beads from Oman, belonging to 3rd millennium BCE, second half of 3rd millennium BCE. Now the question is, you will say, how do you know these are produced in Indus Valley only? But we have a test for it. These type of beads, I have talked already when I was talking at the beads, this is known as ernestite drill. This is the material, because drilling a long bead is a very difficult thing. So they use this type of, Harappans use this type of material to drill. And they leave a very distinctive mark inside the perforations. And if you take this silicon, these are some of the silicon impressions from the Oman beads. And if we have analyzed them under a scanning electronics microscope, and we have compared it with the perforation impressions of the perforations of Indian beads, that the very same, indicating the material going there. Indus weight from Susa in Iran, same weight, same material from which the Harappans used to make beads. Shell bangles, a lot of raw material used to go off shell, to Mesopotamia. These are some of the shell columellas. These were taken to Mesopotamia. They were used there for making these seals. Ladle from Susa, and the handle made in this. Now the question is, why they cannot make handles there? These ladles there, because this shell is not found in the shores of either Oman. So, and not a single site has been found where the shells were produced. So mostly it might have gone one of the sites of Gujarat today. This is very important. I would like to remember you, I have to tell you. These are what we call etched beads or bleached beads. I will tell you about the story of this bleached beads in my next lecture. In my next slide. Thanks for your kind attention. Now, here I'm coming back to these etched beads. This is the last slide of mine. These are known as Z beads, and they are only found in Tibet. These are also dyed beads, and this is very important bead for the Ladakhis and the Tibetan plateau, because they considered it, they were made by the gods and given to them. They were not made by the human beings. And this is supposed to be belonging to early centuries of Christian era. And we think, since there is not much of archaeological work going on in Tibetan area, but this is dyed beads were produced in Harappa and during Harappan times in India, and they went throughout the world. And what was funny about this, my last slide, is that if you have this bead in America, it will fetch you, a single bead will fetch you $60,000. Thank you.
Thank you, Professor Bhan. Friends, we have just heard a very intellectually rich and insightful presentation by Professor Bhan. Is that he may have touched upon the multiple dimensions of the subject, ranging from the skills, the occupational specialization, labor, the raw material, technology and also control and advertise in the country. In fact, he has explained the various contexts to his graphic and to government presentation. In fact, he has also focused as to how the rich and votes not so rich people were served by the technologies of the time. Sometimes he refers to all the things of the same value and the same shape. So, with this kind of this context that we have come across, I now open presentation of this question. Thank you.
I have a couple of questions. First one is about coinage. Now, coinage is not exactly ornaments or crafts, but there's no mention of coinage in the talks, because coinage is something that spreads very widely. We know where it comes from and so on and so forth. So was there coinage? And if it was there, was it studied? That's my first question. Second question is whether there was any quantitative study, because we are hearing descriptions. We are hearing about the use of technology such as electron microscopes and so on. But you know, when you say, for example, that weights were standardized, was there really a statistical study to determine exactly whether they were standardized, whether they had similar means, or whether they were different means, and so on? So there has been no mention of that, just a claim that they were standardized. They may have been, may not have been. So has there been any proper statistical study?
Sir, about coins, in Gujarat, we have not found any coin so far, which we can say this is a coin. In Harappa, Mohenjo-daro, or elsewhere, where there are people who claim there are few coins, but I had not any chance to look at them. Neither they are themselves very sure whether they are coins or not. So I don't know. I don't think we had coins in the Harappan times. It may be the
seals have been coins.
Pardon, sir?
Could the seals have been some sort of currency?
No, they were more administrative rather than, you know, controlling the production, stamping the goods, sending somewhere the others. They will be stamped, closed, so nobody is going to tamper or take things out of it. And they have been used for that purpose. This is the purpose we know what part they were used. And second thing, the question you had about the ways. Yes, sir, we have done, and I can't be able to show it and talk everything about it. Yes, we have done. We have used a very sensitive balance to weight these weights, and we have found they are very, very accurate. Made from that the same material.
I am aware of that this things, the weighing process was very accurate. I'm talking about its statistics. What was the variance? What was the mean?
So I'm not an expert on that, sir. Magar one thing is, yes, a lot of people has done it. Okay. There is a lot of literature which has developed on it, and how the weight developed, why from it has, they say that it started with the rati. That is, the rati is the very close, lowest weight from there. So yes, sir, they have done it.
It was theoretical.
Yes.
It was not derived empirically.
Well,
and
I don't know.
This is something that Kosambi proved to be wrong. That people started with the rati and they came to certain conclusions which are not borne out empirically.
Very maybe, I don't know about that, but there are a lot of people who have done work and they're very accurate weights. I know about that because we used a very sensitive balance to weight them, and they're more, and the weight which is from Mesopotamia, that also falls into the same system, you know, like accurate, very accurate weights. So a lot of standardization. But a lot of people are working. There are various, you know, like, I didn't talk about textile. I didn't talk, there are also crafts. I didn't talk about many crafts because there is not much of information which I could gather. Since since the cloth does not survive. But there are a lot of studies that recently they have found silk in Harappan civilization, which is much, I think, more or less same date going to China. It does not come from China. It is a wild moth from which is the Assami make those silk from there, that tarsa or tassar, tassar silk. So yes, they have found it, and there's a huge paper on a one single thread. So it's not all everything I have covered in my lecture. And second thing is that, sir, in this, I also want to talk, people understand these things. So if I put a lot of things, you know, like, so it will not be enjoying, they will be bored. So I thought of making it more sort of a lecture which is more understood.
Can I ask?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Huh? I'm Subbu.
Yeah.
Okay. I have a couple of queries and
yes, sir.
A few comments.
Yes, sir.
We know, taking off from Professor Raj's question, mm-hmm. we know that Bronze Age cultures, whether in India or Mesopotamia, mm-hmm. did not have coinage or marketplace. They basically had institutionalized exchange, which is uh-huh. not a free open trading kind of a situation where you exchange goods in open market. Mm-hmm. It was an institutionalized exchange. In Mesopotamia, we know that it was a role of the temples and other political institutions
exactly.
in redistributing.
Exactly.
However, in Harappan context, particularly in the Gujarat sites,
mm-hmm.
How do you think this absence of market affect the role of trader? When you say the merchant is controlling production,
yes, sir.
Is it the merchant who is controlling production, or agent of the state who is controlling production? Who is controlling production?
I think
what is a merchant in a economy mm-hmm. which does not have money or a marketplace?
Mm-hmm.
That is question one.
Mm-hmm.
Then I had a couple of other queries about you make a very important distinction between goods which are manufactured with simple techniques locally and goods which are manufactured with complex techniques from with imported or distant source raw materials.
Yes.
In any urban site, what is the relation between these two kind of production centers? You know? What is the quantum of produce of locally available simple technology? And I think it's a kind of a quantification which we need to do. Related to this is the question of, do you have campsites? Like I think you mentioned this shank manufacturing or shank processing.
Yes,
so that should be a campsite which is, you know, just adjacent to a raw material site.
Mm-hmm.
Now, do we see a pattern in these kind of settlements? You know, that is the second question.
Yes, sir.
Third is relating to the question of tax. You said that they were taxed.
Yes, sir.
Now, I have a problem with this notion of tax in a Bronze Age culture, particularly like Harappan. See, if there is no money, how do you tax? Do you collect a part of the produce? If you collect part of the produce, do you have evidence for the keeping and storing and processing of that produce, share of that produce? What do you mean by tax in a, in an archaeological sense? How do you prove that there was taxation? That is all.
Many questions. First, marketplaces. If I have missed, you should ask me again. I will answer all these questions together. First, your question about marketplaces. I think we have a question of, we have some notion mind about something like malls and or shopping areas. No, there are places, there are places which are open. Say, for example, Lothal has a very big open area. There is no architecture. It could have been used for games. It could also used for melas. There are melas where there's a lot of exchange going on in the melas. Say, cow mela, Gada Mela, they are the places where a lot of exchange takes place. So markets are there, but in a very different... and the site I was excavating, Shikarpur near Kutch, we also had all around there were village, there were houses, people living, craftsmen, everything. In the in between, there was a huge area which was left vacant, which could have been used. There's no proof to prove it. This could have been used for... games, sometimes games, sometimes for the marketplace. And if you look at these, what we call in Gujarat, there are a lot of cattle melas, even today. So if you go to, it's not only selling of cattle, there's a lot of things happening else other than this. People coming with their wares, coming with their goods and selling. Yes, you are correct in saying that so far in the Bronze Age, whether it is Mesopotamian, Egyptian or Indian, there's no coinage so far identified. Or second, when I say tax, it is of whatever you produce, you give a part of it. If you look at the Mesopotamians, since there are written records, the temple used to ask them whatever they produce. They have to give a certain amount of, whether there was a produce or this agricultural productions or whether it is a craft. And then you said how taxes were collected. As I told you that we always have been given a notion that this fortification, when we say fortification, that gives us an idea of it is associated with fiber of military fortified. If we say periphery wall, it changes the whole concept about it. And it has four gates. And it is around these gates we usually find that a lot of weights are found. So perhaps what weights were necessary around the gate? Somebody going outside the village, or outside the town or a city, he has to pay tax if he's carrying certain goods. In the form of the goods he's, when he comes back, whatever he has brought, he has paid the tax in the form of those goods only. So there was no transition of money involved in that. Anything I left? Anything I have not touched upon?
Anyone else? Oh, exactly, you said another question you had asked Professor Subramaniam. You asked about maybe these camps. We have a lot of camps. They were basically associated with the nomadic camps who used to carry from one place to another in search of pastures, their cattle, sheep and goat. But they also did a lot of, used to buy things, bring things, a lot of raw materials with them, because they used to go on very long distance while coming back to their village. They would bring a lot of other materials. This used to happen for salt as well. A lot of salt is to be distributed to various places for these nomads.
Actually, I have a supplementary question if no one else has asked.
Yeah, please.
Okay. This is actually about organization of craft production. You made a very important the process of production tells us about how production is organized. Now, looking at the camps, looking at the manufacturing sites, and the storage sites and so on, can you make a generalization? What is the status of the craftspersons? Status of the craftsperson in the country, like you talked about carnelian and other things, and status of artisans who are producing locally made materials. Do you find any distinction between the status of the artisan in terms of the control exercised over them and the material goods in their residences?
Yes, sir. Yes, we do find the people who are bigger workshop owners, if you look at their architecture around their houses, that is more important. They are more pakka makan. Pakka unke jo ghar mein se aapko milega hoard of beads. You may find a hoard of copper vessels. So there is definitely that there is indications of that they were richer than the rest of the people who were there. Especially, we don't find these craft. As I told you, this is a wrong notion has been given to us that everything was standardized. Standardization means occupational specialization. Actually, there are various crafts where if they needed the control, then they were controlled. If they were not needed, say for example, making the blades, every household was making their own blades. So similarly, there were lot other types of beads which I didn't talk much. There are other types of beads which are not that important as carnelian is. All sites produce such beads. There was a small area, or these two, three people produce such beads because there was no investment involved, a lot of money involved into that. They were not technology as spread as the long carnelian beads were. Carnelian beads were, it is found so far, these long carnelian beads were produced from a single site, which is known as Chandadaro in Pakistan. No other site. We get long beads everywhere, but we don't see the manufacturing of it. So there was only one single site which were producing long carnelian beads, that is at Chandadaro. The smaller beads and of different materials, they were produced at many places. Harappa, Mohenjo-daro, a lot of sites in Gujarat. Then, if you look at the architecture associated with these produce who are producing these long beads, carnelian beads, it's much superior than the architecture which is associated with other crafts. And it's still true, the beads which this type of long carnelian beads produced in Khambhat. First of all, that workshop has been closed because they went to America. They settled in America, so the workshop is not. But if you look at the how much wealthy they were, very powerful people. They will purchase material and then the bad quality material, which was not good for them, even though it was carnelian, was sold to those who produce smaller beads. Very powerful people in that area. And they produce really, really good beads. I'll tell you a funny story, which I don't have to go into details, but I will just briefly tell you a story. It took us 6 years to pursue that gentleman to allow us to see how these are made. He never allowed us. 1 year we went again to see him. He will not even ask us to come up in his house. But last year, I think in 79 or 80, we went there. His father promised us that you come and you study us as long as you want to study. Then what we did, we went the next year to study there. But what happened, sir, that man had passed away. The father had passed away. Then we were worried whether the son would allow us, because they never wanted to show how they control these heating of the beads. We never knew. We used to go everywhere, every day, every year to meet them. we were not aware about that. The kills are inside their house and they are there only. Such, this is how they control the knowledge. And they were developed, they are very rich people. And this, it was their traditional business since grandfather's time.
Can I ask a question?
Yes, please, please.
Yes, yes. Yes, sir, thank you for the presentation. Sir, actually, I was, you had mentioned that there are no big monuments big monuments were are not found during the excavation. It's generally the kind of materials that we find are the smaller materials. According to you, do you think it sort of reflects upon the kind of government or the kind of social, social reality at that time, maybe unavailability of free labor, which would work on such big monuments, because historically big monuments are generally built, many times it happens that there is a large amount of free labor available or there's this one monarch or, there's this strictly hierarchical form of government where when such large monuments were built historically. So does that sort of reflect on the kind of government that was, or the kind of social structure that was prevalent in that time in that area?
It is perhaps more of sensibility, Indian sensibility, which is different from any other sensibility. If you go to Greece, they always made huge lot of emphasis on muscles, lot of naturalistic figures. If you look at our sculptures, they're so different. The sensibility is very different. Look at the Shiva, which is 4th century, 10th century, 7th century. They have a different, it is a very different sensibility. Okay. And Indians were perhaps more wise than anybody else. They never wanted to bury their wealth in those monuments with the dead. Here we pass on to our daughters, to our sons. And this is a sensibility. Okay. And what is good? And then there is equal amount of technology needed for producing a monumental and to producing a smallest. The technology is needed for both. It is what you like.
Okay.
Whole Europe became then from Greece to Italy, and Italy to whole Europe, even America. So it is Greek architecture, Renaissance, mein fir se Michelangelo ne wahi banaya jo pehle banta tha. Yeah, sensibility.
It's more about sensibility.
Abhi bhi dekhe, hamare mein, so these days, we make miniatures, Mughal time, Rajput miniatures. Yeah. They have to be appreciated from very closeness. They're not appreciated from distance. It's not Michelangelo's Christ. It's sensibility, basically. It is what you like, what is pleasing to you. And then as an aesthetics, it's not something universal. What is good for you may not necessarily good for me. It may not be. So it's basically sensibility.
Okay.
And then the monuments. It's not that we have not made monuments, but comparatively, not senseless monuments. We do have like Great Bath is a big bath at Mahenjo-daro. There are some architecture which are clearly, if you go to Dholavira, you will get impressed. 11, 12 meters wall standing today, the fortification wall. Look at the gopura of the gate, you will find that you will get the vibration that, but it's very different. It's functional. It's okay. Not a monument over the dead.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. I'll just come in the last point. I believe that they did anything except to copy from the Iranians on the one hand and the Egyptians on the other. If you see their architecture, for example, the pillars, it was so characteristic. They are found earlier in Egypt. They are found very much in Persepolis. And as a matter of fact, they are even found in South America among the Maya, who also built pyramids. A very strong similarity, and the Greeks come quite late. So now there was, as you said, a lot of trade with Iraq and Iran. Susa, you mentioned, and you mentioned Mesopotamia. And so Egypt was also part of this. So how come there was this kind of differentiation between this Harappan stuff and the Egyptian and the Babylonian? I was just curious about that. Yeah, that's my question. That's if you have an answer.
Sir, I think you need to unmute. You're on mute.
Muted. You're muted.
Yeah.
Okay. I said material, Indian material has been found there, but we have not found anything which belongs to Mesopotamia or any other country or Oman in our sites. So, but then what was the material? Could be maybe organic material we used to run them there, which doesn't last so long. But why this architecture? Why we never got influenced by them, you know, like even though we had trade relations with them.
This but that's much later. Much later. Yeah. Not at that
early stage. No, I said what I was trying to tell you, these columns and these big things. That it never came this side, it went all this, that side up to, as I told you, if you were to look at the American architecture, that is same architecture.
Should we close now the discussion? Well, thank you, Professor Bhan, for your very interesting presentation with the depth and range which you covered in your research. I wish you all the very best on the behalf of all fellows present or absent today, and wish you all success in your academic pursuits. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much, sir.